All right, this is whatever that is right there on the board. Law and grace, lambs and law, beasts and fleece. Basically what we're trying to do is we're trying to find the real core issues of law and the nature of Christ. And law deals with since we've started this new semester, we've been looking at it from a perspective of the book of Revelation and seeing that when it's all said and done in the book of Revelation, that we have a dividing where it's lamb and his followers, and it's beasts and their followers. And we see certain specific traits of both groups. And last class, we were in a section called Not Comprehending the Importance of Death, which we didn't finish that. So in line with comprehending the importance of death, and one of the things that I mentioned there was on the road to Emmaus, the scriptures in Luke 24 talk about them walking along and they're discussing Jesus' death and they're discouraged. Now, Jesus' death and resurrection was the high point of all creation, of all reality, of all victories. They're walking along discouraged because they've misunderstood the cross, and to them it wasn't working. It's not working. And so Jesus draws near, and instead of going, "Look, it's me," because he didn't do that at first, he took them to the scriptures and he began to share himself from the scriptures. And you'd think, if you know we don't need the scriptures anymore. You're right here. Okay, there's a certain amount of truth to that, but the Lord, like in John 5:39, very early on, he says, "Search the scriptures, they testify of me." Why wouldn't he just say, "Look, I'm it. Just get to know me." You may see the value of the scriptures from Jesus' perspective. And if Jesus holds that important to us, then we should. So anyway, in looking at the importance and the value of death, of course, it's obviously valuable because there's no resurrection without one. But I want you to turn to Romans chapter 6 with me, and we're going to just take a few little scriptures here to continue this discussion. We could call this class dealing with beasts, if you want to, because Romans 6 has kind of been dealing with beasts, our beasts. I think this is a NIV here that I'll read. "Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its evil desires." Is that pretty clear that there's some beasts in there? And it's interesting that he doesn't say, "Now, you know, you need to go to the cross." He doesn't say, it's kind of wild that he just goes, "Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its evil desires." Don't do it. Don't do it. Okay, so I'm just going to read my little thing. "Therefore," this is another translation. "Therefore," another translation with my stuff added in. "Therefore, you, based on the cross in verse 1 through 10, and upon the Lamb nature, do not let sin nature reign in your mortal body." Does that make sense? Because Romans 6, 12 is also based on Romans 6, 1 through 10. "And for you're dead," you know, the scriptures begin to declare that reality of death with Christ. And so basically he's in verse 7 he says, reckon yourselves in to be dead indeed unto sin. So here he's no longer describing to you that work that he did on Calvary. He's not discussing that. He is discussing your responsibility to the cross. That's all. He's not. See, other people would read this and they would read this scripture and they say, oh, okay, so I'm supposed to stop sinning and I'll do it because I love Jesus. I'm just going to stop right now. Ready? And there's not going to be any more beasts in me, which is putting yourself under the law, which is the quickest way to explode with beastly seed. Yeah, it is. It's the quickest way, you know, to proliferate beasts like crazy in you. But Paul is not going at this the law method. In fact, in chapter 7, which is just a few verses down, when he gets into it, he starts saying, you were married to something. You were married to the old man, which he calls the old man, in that case, the law. And he says, but your husband is dead, and now you can be married to another. Amen? Amen. And so there's a reality that Paul has pertaining to the cross that isn't just simple salvation. It isn't just basic Christianity. It is basic Christianity to him. I like Watchman Nee's book, The Normal Christian Life, and it starts describing us being dead with Christ and Christ being our life. That's the normal Christian life. But Paul's insight into, and you have to say into Jesus, because to truly start understanding on that level, you're understanding the lamb nature. You're understanding that these are issues of nature. And in fact, here in Romans 6:12, when it talks about the word sin, let not sin, guess what? Guess what that word is? Sin nature. It's not sins. It's sin nature. And why would it say don't let sin nature reign in you? Because over here it says, know ye not. Don't you know that as many of us as were baptized into Christ were baptized into his death? All right, so I wrote again, therefore you, based on the cross in verse 1 through 10, and upon the lamb nature, do not let sin reign in your mortal body. You can have power to stop it, but that power is the power of the cross. But don't look at the cross as a power against beasts. The cross is a power against you. You're the one crucified, not the beasts. Satan is never crucified. Well, that was an eye-opener to me. You begin to realize God is trying to deal with us. So you have power to stop it. How do you stop it? Not by conquering the beast within, but the same way as Jesus, by death. If the beasts are still roaming free in you, then you may know all about the cross, but you have not yet partaken of the communion of Jesus' death. And what I mean by that is communion, literal communion, is supposed to be showing forth his death and our death with him. And it is a declaration of that death. You don't have to declare life if it's life. You have to declare life if religion is pawning itself off as life and say, look, that's life because they're dancing on one foot or whatever. You know, see, that's, it may be lively, but it's not necessarily life, see. And so you don't have to declare life. Life will live if it's truly life. If it's doctrines of life, if it's teachings of life, if it's a dedication to not teaching death but life, if it's any of that stuff, good luck with it. Because you'll be dealing with beasts all the time. The cross is God's answer. It's that simple. You say, yeah, it's God's answer for them beasts. Yeah, us and them, you know. And then that communion table. The table was always a place of communion, but Jesus' communion table was a place of partaking of his broken body. See, Israel, when on the Passover, which took place on the same day that communion took place, just, you know, a couple of thousand years earlier, they ate the lamb. They ate the lamb. They weren't cannibals in the sense that they ate living lambs. They showed forth his death. They partook of his death. They put his death on the inside of them. And that's what they were doing. And it wasn't just putting death in there. Well, I'll just, you know, there's some roadkill out here, and that's death, and I'm going to eat that. And God's going to bless it. I don't think so. It's lamb death. It is selfless. It is for others. And it doesn't have to declare itself. So, why have the Jews always and to this day had problems trying to occupy the land God has already given to them? Because they did not drive out the inhabitants. They dealt with some, but others were allowed to stay. The end result was that with time, they too began worshiping some of the idols of the foreigners. What are idols? Idols are perverted images. Okay, so the image of God is Christ crucified. That's where you're going to get the clearest, clear-cut image of what God is like. That's where you're going to see beyond religion. You're going to see beyond, and when I say religion, at least right now when I'm saying it, religion, I'm talking about an act of God done religiously to save us and to bring us into a religion. You'll see that thing without religion. You'll go, oh my God, this is just the way he is. It's really cool. I mean, it's really cool because we're saved and all of that takes place, but I'm talking about seeing that and beyond. You understand what I'm saying? I'm saying, yes, you comprehend that, but, you know, it's like for years I've been in churches and stuff, and I would go to church and I would see people go down to the altar. Some people, every week, they'd go down to the altar and get saved. And I'm thinking, you know, when are they going to just believe? You know, thank God Mike isn't here tonight, but because we got stories about this boy. Anyway, you know, there's only so much that you can figure out about his death for your sins. And eventually, if there's not more depth to it, people go, well, I'm saved, then I'm going to leave the church. Who needs it? They preach the same thing every Sunday. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Okay. So, but all of a sudden, when you start seeing past all of that, not, you know, as if it's not, doesn't count, we'd all be in hell if it didn't count. But I'm just saying, to what is beyond that, what produced that, and what is the spirit that was that spirit when there was no need before time? And what will he be like after time? Lamb slain on a throne. And what will we be married to? We'll be the wife of the raccoon. No, the lamb. You know, I'm just making sure y'all are paying attention. All right, so First John 3:6. I think I'll just read my version here. I The Bible I'm using, actually, I bought at Half Price Books. And I just opened it, and it just fell open to Revelation 22, the last chapter. I don't know if you can see this. This is whoever owned it before wrote this in there. Now at the bottom. I'll tell you if you can't. It says, amen, 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 the end. Ooh, they were pretty happy. It's like, yeah. Okay, sorry. 1 John 3:6. No one who lives in him keeps on sinning. No one continues to sin nature either, or let's put it this way, no one who continues to sin has either seen him, and this is sin nature, has either seen him or known him. All right. Now yours probably reads slightly different, but it says the same thing. That's pretty powerful, wouldn't you say? No one who lives in him keeps on sinning. No one who continues to sin nature has either seen him or known him. All right. So, you know, I don't know about you. When I first got saved, you know, and I read that and I went, I'm not even saved. I'm not saved. I'm still doing stuff and I'm trying to get out. Anyway, is there anyone buying nails up there? Anyway, so I just wrote after this, the Jesus we're supposed to see and know is our life. We're not just supposed to know the Savior. Is that right or wrong? I mean, you know, every one of us supposedly asked Jesus into our heart in terms of being our life. And that's supposedly a big part of Christianity. So, the scripture says, okay, we're talking about life now. We're not just talking about committing sins. We're talking about having another nature, okay? Do you believe that your old man can be dead and you can still sin? Yeah, you commit a sin. I'm talking about the fruit. Yes, of course you can. Trust me, I know you do it all the time. I'm totally aware of it, and it breaks my heart. But nonetheless, I'll go on. All right, so the Jesus we're supposed to see and know is our life, not our doctrine or helper. To know him as our life presupposes that we first entered in through the door of his death. To know him as our life, because he's not going to be our life if we're our life. He said, Paul said, I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, Christ liveth in me. And so there is an understanding in God's heart. See, in God's heart, the old man's dead. It's not like, you know, it's the yin and the yang, you know what I'm talking about? And, you know, and what they teach is, well, you have a good person in you, and you have a bad person in you. And they're always fighting, you know. Or, you know, you have a good dog and a bad one, but they're fighting for supremacy. The cross finished all of that. You know? I mean, either we believe that or we don't. And see, we're talking about the book of Revelation, we're talking about how to deal with beasts, but we're talking about the law. Instead of trying to shape up something that God says is dead, that's doing away with the law, because it's doing away with any righteousness of our own except Christ. See? All right. So, he is a lamb who died to put away these things. While we may stand on grace in a manner that allows us to live contrary, in reality, we've been graced to death. And I mean that in a good way. I mean, we have been in a negative way, too. Actually, in a negative way, you could say we've been graced to life. We're, by grace, somehow we're living when we're supposed to be dead. It was grace that took us into death. Hebrews 2:9, by the grace of God, he tasted death for every man. God's grace should lead us to our death. By the grace of God, he tasted death for every man. He He took every man into death by the grace of God. God made man in his image, but man marred that image. He no longer makes us in his image, but makes us as one. He no longer makes us in his image, he makes us as one, and he is meant to be the image in us. What? If the goal was just to save us, Jesus could have died and just left, and he wouldn't have had to come into us. Is that right? I mean, he would have just died and gone up there and go, okay, you're saved, live like it, you know? But he came into us because he's not standing over here and you're there and he's going, I'm going to make you into my image. No, he's going to put you to death. He's going to put you to death. But then he's going to make you one with him, bone of his bone and flesh of his flesh, and by oneness you have that image because Jesus is the express image of God. See, some people don't like teaching like this because they go, well, you're taking away anything from us. You know, you're taking away our, you know, the whatever. And you make too, you know, I've had people say, you make too much out of Jesus. Really? Really? He must be small because I'm not doing a very good job because considering his greatness. So that oneness is the key. And Jesus started that oneness in death. He took we became one with him in death. You can't even die right. You can't. Look at Adam and Eve. In the day that you eat, you shall surely die. So they eat, and what do? Die? No, they go hide. I didn't do it, she did. Well, I didn't do it, that serpent did. See? Adam will always run from death. You say, why do the heathen rage? Why do the people get upset with preaching that we're crucified with Christ? Because Adam will always run from death. Always. It's our nature. It's our nature. So Jesus in the garden drinks the cup, joins with us, goes to the cross and dies and puts us to death. But because he never sinned, the soul that sins shall die, because he never sinned, he could be raised from the dead. But we could be raised now, but only if we're one with him, not raised with him, raised as one with him. Big difference, people. Big difference. A big difference. And besides, if you love Jesus, wouldn't you rather be one with him instead of some big shot apart from him, for him? I mean, I'm serious. Yeah.
Something the Lord shared with me recently. He says in Revelation 12, he's talking about the woman who was with child, and it says, behold, a great sign in heaven. This woman, she's clothed with the sun, and the moon is under her feet. And the Lord's kind of sharing with me how she was clothed with the sun. The moon is, you know, the sun casts shadows on the moon, and there's reflections of the sun on the moon. She's not beholding the moon. She's not living in shadows. She's not studying, you know, how the sun reflects and looking at that.
Right.
She's not even, in a sense, beholding the sun in all its glory. She's being clothed upon. She's clothed upon with the sun.
Amen.
She's not just beholding. She's embracing that oneness that you're talking about. And there. She's with him. She's in him. He's in her.
Amen. Amen. That's scripture. I think it's in 2 Corinthians. It says, it starts talking about putting off this house of this frame and everything. And it says, not that we would be, I mean, Paul is so good. He's so good. Not that we would be unclothed, like going back to Adam and Eve in the garden and getting rid of the junk and then being free again, but clothed upon, exactly what you're saying, but clothed upon, that mortality might be swallowed up of life. Can you get any more plain than that? That's just it. That's just it. All right, now he tells us to conform to him. We are to walk through hell in order to obtain and display his image through us, meaning that that we're not afraid of facing the valley of the shadow of death, or facing people being against us, or trials, or this and that, because those become the avenue whereby we can actually let His true image shine out of us. I'm just weird, so just forgive the example or whatever. It'd be like in a church service, and I'm up here, and I go, okay, I'm going to pray for you, and God, the power of God is going to heal you. And so I pray for them, and they get healed, and they go, and they look, and they go, oh, Brother Randy, I see Jesus in you, and that's fine. But to lay down your life for someone who doesn't deserve it, which is what Jesus did, and to be accused of everything that they are, which is what Jesus did, someone may look and go, I see the Lamb in you. I see the crucified in you. Now, that's the image of God, folks. Healing is fine, but it's not the image of God unless you see it from a slain lamb and a flow that's going out to the nations. If you see it in that light and you follow the trail, you got to follow the trail. You can't just look at healing. That's not the image. You follow the trail, past the tree of life, past the river, get up to the transparent walls of New Jerusalem, the wife of the Lamb, go through the gates, go in there, come up to a throne, and see what's sitting on the throne, and you go, there's the image of God. And out of it is all things, the source of all things, and ultimately is all things. Because the truth is, that river that's flowing from the throne that the slain Lamb is on, that's His flow. I mean, it's still Him. He's the river of life. He's the living waters. You know that, don't you? Yeah, you know. But living waters isn't the source or the fountainhead. That's right. Follow it till you see the Lamb. Stay with it. Don't give up, because you're going to see a lot of cool stuff along the way. And it's really cool, but it's nothing compared to seeing Him. See, that's the deal. It's nothing compared to seeing Him. But instead, as is the case in we're to walk through hell in order to obtain and display His image through us. But instead, as in the case of the churches in chapter 2-3 in Revelation, we are seeking to do the right thing, the law, and avoid the wrong thing. We must eventually move from each of these things to move to the things that are above, where the Lamb is seated. So, in the talking about Revelation chapter 2, chapter 3, the letters to the seven churches, and I probably deal with that somewhere, maybe way down the line, I don't know. I just remember the Holy Spirit speaking to me, and he said, just walk through chapter 2 and 3. Just walk through these letters. Walk through Jesus not appearing or showing Himself as the Lamb, you know, but having to write a letter and go, here, read this. Walk through it with me. And I said, okay. And so He started taking me there. And it was like, oh, my God. The high point was, I know your works and your patience and, you know, your faithfulness, and you've stood against this and that and that. And the other stuff was, you know, you got the Nicolaitans still with you. Or, you know, I'm glad you don't put up with the Jews. How low can you go on the totem pole of, you know, because right after this, John looks and behold, the door's open in heaven, and he's caught up there, and you know, he was in the Spirit on the Lord's day in the earth. Something greater than a really cool Lord's Day service happened. He was taken into another realm of Jesus that hardly ever used the name Jesus anymore, but called Him Lamb. And then a process starts. And, okay, so let, you know, I mean, but he's over here on the Isle of Patmos, okay? This is John here, and he's in exile. It's poor John. He's in exile. And here he is out here. Let me move this. And so we go, you know, and he says, I, John, your brother in tribulation, carrying the testimony of Jesus. Most of that we don't even understand. He is comforting these seven churches with these words, that he's going through the same stuff, but with purpose. He is. That's what's going on. He's not going, this is pitiful, isn't it? You know, we're all in a mess. No, he's come with truth from above. So he starts talking and he goes, okay, so I'm in exile, but at least on the Lord's day, I was in the Spirit. Praise God. It better be more than that. No, there's a door opened in heaven. And here is the Lamb of God seated on the throne. And he sees everything pointed towards that Lamb. Wow. Worshiping what? A lamb? No, slain lamb. Original Greek, slaughtered lamb. Okay? Worshiping that. And so, what happens? And I don't want to mess up people's writing here, but he starts in a process that no longer has to do with seven churches over here and all of their problems and a few compliments. He is caught up here and he shoots down this pipeline of reality and goes, and he goes all the way down to the Lamb's wife and the Lamb, and he hasn't even left confinement. Woo. Yeah. He hasn't even left confinement yet. We're going, just get me out of here, Lord. Just get me off of this stinking island. Any of the Irish watching right now? Anyway, just kidding, if you are. No, it's not Christianity as we know it in the earth. Get me out of this. No, it is everything up here is going into death for something greater. What greater? So that we might become the wife of the bride. No. God, no. So that he would get one after his kind. Come on. It can't always be about us. Please, no. I just want to be a bride. Shut up. I'm sorry, you know. But that is wrong. That is, you're the emphasis. You're the beauty. You're the thing that's glorious. And you've reached the pinnacle of everything. Well, guess what? You'll never reach it with that attitude. That's the exact opposite of what he's looking for. See, but to see him and to be changed into that same image, you don't even know it. You said, well, how do you know that? You don't own everything. I do, but I don't know that. Because, what did I say? I can't even remember. What? Yeah, well, when I was just saying something about how do I know, what statement did I make? Oh, gosh, it was just a scripture. It was just a simple scripture that just showed us that whatever that statement was, it just showed us that we only know that by Christ. We only know it by Christ. Oh, I remember what it was. You know, how do we know it? We're changed from glory to glory. See, if our focus is on us changing, then we're focused on us. Now, you tell me your opinion. Your opinion doesn't count, neither does mine. But could it be your opinion? Well, only what the Lord says counts. Could your opinion say that most people, most Christians, their Christian walk is a walk of focusing on themselves to become a better Christian or something? I think that's true. I don't think we're being mean with that. I don't think it's mean until you see it in the light of his face. And that's not mean, it's just not right. Yes.
Wouldn't it be true that one of the reasons why, as a bride, you can't reach the pinnacle is to be the bride, you have to be completely empty of you, and he's your fullness. And
right.
You can't ever see him as your fullness when you look at you.
Right.
You can't. So you can be operating fully in bride, like transparent glass, and you have no idea.
Right.
And from a certain angle, because you're focused on him,
right.
You can be thinking about the laundry. I mean,
right.
Really, or just, being in tune with him, and people are seeing Christ in ways that you are unaware.
Right.
And you're not controlling or contriving it or orchestrating bride.
Amen. Well, the example I was going to use, and that's why I was trying to remember what I said. The example I was going to use was Moses when he was up there in the presence of God. And he's there for, 40 days or something like that? I mean, it's just some long amount of time. And when he comes down, his face is glowing, but he doesn't know it. Do you remember that? They had to tell him, oh, my God, look, buddy. He's going, really? Because he's not looking at himself. He didn't take one step down, the hill towards the people and pull out a mirror and go, yeah, I'm going to take it. Yeah. Look, I'm glowing. my Lord. He was totally focusing on the Lord. Caught up above, just like John, caught up above to seeing him there. And guess what? Over in, 2 Corinthians 3 is all primarily about him and his veil and all this kind of stuff. And guess what the subject is? The law or the spirit? The law or the spirit? We either see Jesus and are changed, or we're trying to change ourselves. And the book of Revelation, what is the book of Revelation about? Well, when it comes to Christians, here's what the book of Revelation is about. The book of Revelation is about losers. They got left behind. These are the people who didn't get it right when they had the chance. That's not what it's about. It's about you and me and anyone else who will go through these things by his spirit and in his nature. And in doing that, where's my chalk? In doing that, that progression changes us from this seven churches with all the problems and just a few compliments from the Lord. You read it sometime. I have some things I like about you. You've been faithful to the work, and you've been faithful in patience, and you got rid of the Nicolaitans. Yeah, or whatever. So, but over here, it's like, I'm progressing out of that. I'm looking more and more at him and not at me or my status. And as I do, I'm being transformed, changed. Doesn't it say when we look in his face, we'll be changed from glory to glory, from one kind of glory to the other. I'm being changed into what? Same what? There it is. Genesis 1:26. The reinstatement of the image of God in us. Okay, so, but here, down here, it's not seven churches that are struggling to stay committed or whatever. It is wife. Of Jesus? No. Wife of the King of Kings and Lord of Lords? No. Wife of, we can go through everything that we all want. I mean, who wants to be the wife of a slaughtered lamb? Let me see a show of hands. Well, y'all don't count. Of course you do. But in real life, come on. In real life, let's put it this way. A girl is looking for a really nice looking guy who's got money and got, all this stuff, fame and, all these things. She is. She's looking for that. So they're presented with this slaughtered lamb, Loser, how'd you get all them wounds going into battle? Oh, I know who won. No, you don't. If you're judging by that, you don't know at all. You don't know at all. Wrong value system. But the only way, and it's been said, but the only way we're going to get this in that spirit is as we continue to behold him, we're going to see beauty that we could never have seen before. We're going to see attributes that are almost devoid in the world. I mean, we got a political thing going on right now, and I hear from some of the candidates, it's just like, oh my God, every time somebody says something negative about them, they have something negative to say back. Somebody said, well, this person would probably be a good president because they know how to run a corporation. Let me just tell you something. This fellowship almost sunk because somebody stepped up and wanted to overthrow me and wanted to be the pastor of the church because they believed they could do a better job because they were a successful businessman. When they did, I don't know why they were complaining, because when they did, we had a ton of money in the bank. We really did. God was blessing for no reason at all. Ton of money. We did. And he was blessed in so many fronts. And when this guy got through, that money was almost depleted. Just thrown away. Takes money to get money. That's what he said. You say, well, why'd you let him do that? Yeah, it had something to do with the lamb. And it ended up turning, of course. But he came to me and said, I'm an idiot. I do not ever want to be a pastor again. This is the hardest job in the world. I can't believe it. You can't use principles of the world to run God's kingdom. You can't do it. It's ridiculous. All right, I need to read. In David's case, he continually looked as if he and his men were breaking the law. That's how he appeared to everyone. David appeared as if he's continually and his men breaking the law, yet he was more in the image of the Lamb than his accusers. Right? Yes. He was. Okay, let's try Jesus then. I don't believe that about David. Let's try Jesus. Jesus was constantly accused of breaking the law, was he not? There was always stuff going at him. But would eventually die for the very ones who thought that he was off from the truth of God. He didn't condemn them. He died for them while they accused him. I mean, even while they accused him, not counting his whole ministry, but, when he's before Pilate, when he's hanging on the cross, and wrong concepts of the cross and of death and of life and everything. If you're the Son of God, come down from the cross. And that's what most Christians believe. If you're a son of God, if you're really of God, then you ought to be able to get out of your problems. But because he's the Son of God, he stayed up there. Because he's a true Son of God. Now, when I say Son of God, I'm not talking about somebody who's just born again but acts like a self-centered baby. I'm talking about a mature in Christ, Christ formed in them, and therefore his ways being their ways. So we think that being religiously correct is the important thing, but being in the correct image is what matters to God. See? Do you think it's possible to actually fail, have the image of God and actually fail and look bad to everybody, and you're still of God? Well, I would hope so. You know what I mean? If not, we're all in trouble. My God. I mean, and if you go, Saul, King Saul, well, he was tall, and David wasn't all that tall, and he was, you know, had a lot of stuff going for him. And when he first got chosen to be king, he was a good man. It all went to his head. David, you know, if you go through the stuff that Saul did wrong, and just by religious kind of what most people, how they value things, you know, well, he didn't kill what's his name, Agag, because, you know, he kept the sheep, and that's okay. We can use that. See, that's, if it wasn't clearly written in the scripture that that was wrong, we'd have probably done it. But, you know, he just didn't kill Agag. He made a prisoner out of him, which is what we do to Adam. We lock him up, lock Adam up in the worst possible stinky dungeon there is, us. David, he did way worse stuff. And yet, he was a man with a heart after God. God knows. And if you're after the image, if you're after that image, if you want that image, there'll be incredible things happen. There'll be failures. There'll be deaths. And there'll be resurrections. I mean, I remember one time, at one point, there were enemies attacking this church and attacking me, and they, at one point, had my throat, as it were, down on the ground for the count, spiritually. And they said, somebody told me what they said, and they said, you know, just a little while longer and new creation will be dead. Those people will be dead, and Randy will be dead, you know, wiped out. And one of them said, yeah, but don't they believe in life after death? So these, if anybody preaches that stuff, these guys, this is, you know, I don't know if this is. That's right. If they had have known, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. All right. In Revelation 2:10, turn there with me. Revelation 2:10. This is a good one. Do not be afraid of what you are about to suffer. Okay, here's what I put, listen to this. This is really important and it's good. Here's what I put in parentheses after it. So I'm going to read it and then I'm going to read what I put in parentheses. Do not be afraid of what you are about to suffer. Trust death. We go, I'm not afraid of what I'm going to suffer because I'll be with Jesus. And if they kill me, bless God, I'll be with the Lord. But you're not trusting death. You're just a Christian trusting that Jesus is going to take care of you. But death, there is a power in his kind of death. There's a power in it that, in the book of Revelation, defeats beasts. In the book of Romans, defeats your beasts. And it is. Trust death. I tell you, the devil will put some of you in prison to test you. What? Now, who's doing the testing here? The devil will put you in prison to test you. Is it the devil that's testing you? And what is he testing if he's testing you? It's God allowing him to do that. Now, why would God do that? In fact, I've got, where is that? We'll get to it. Let's just read on. To test you, and you will suffer persecution. Be faithful, even to the point of death. Be faithful. Okay, I'm going to be faithful to God. No, be faithful to the death. Be faithful all the way to that point of selfless giving, and I will give you a crown of gold. a crown of life. Is it any better than that? That life comes out of death. You'll be crowned with life. Praise God. If we see this, then we're going to see something. If we don't see it, it's just a teaching. Yeah.
Later in that chapter, he says, "He who overcomes and keeps my works,
yes,
I will give power to overcome, to have power over the nations."
Amen. Yeah.
Then just a few verses later, he's talking to the next church in chapter 3. He's to Sardis. He says, "I know your works, and you think that you have a name."
Right.
"That you say that you have a name, that you are alive and not dead."
Right.
Wow.
All right. If we remain in limitation, injustice, etc., and do so by his nature, carrying forth his image, then we will be qualified to govern with him. 2 Timothy 2:12, if we endure, we shall also reign with him. If we disown him, the Lamb, the crucified, he will disown us. If we disown the Lamb and his nature and his way, Romans 8:17, now, if we are children, then are heirs, if indeed we share in his sufferings. He gives you the grace to stay in death. He gives you the grace to stay in death, as seen in 2 Corinthians 12:9. "But he said unto me, my grace is sufficient. Stay down in this death. Don't ask for deliverance. My grace is sufficient." Trust death, Paul. Trust it. We all may read of the many things that Paul endured for the Lord. Then why would the Lord add a messenger of Satan to Paul's burden? I mean, that just sounds cruel, doesn't it? I mean, it does to me. It's like, my God, this guy's caring so much for it. Not counting all the care of all the churches, as he described it. He did so that Paul would not merely experience the sufferings of Christ, but enter into fellowship in his sufferings. A certain amount of people experience the sufferings of Christ, but they never enter into the fellowship of it, see? It's never a point of fellowship with them in death, in loss, in limitations that others may have life. They don't fellowship in that. They might endure it, because somehow they believe, you know, and that's just a wrong concept. I'm telling you, one of the things I hate the most is wrong concepts of the cross, because that there are people that just go through junk thinking that there's something virtuous about going through junk. I don't believe that. I never have believed that there's something virtuous simply by suffering. There is something virtuous about entering into his sufferings and fellowshipping with him in it. And many times we won't fellowship with him because we're not convinced. We'll hold our breath, we'll go through it, we'll be a good Christian, we'll be a good, you know, Bible school student or new creationite or whatever you want to call yourselves. Who are y'all anyway? But you're just going, well, you know, Randy teaches this, so I should do this, you know. It probably would look bad for me to throw a fit in the middle of the church and say, I want deliverance now. So we silently suffer. That's not the Lord, and that's not what I'm teaching. It's not what I'm teaching. I hate that. And I've had people come to me who had been here for years tell me, you know, fellowshipping with me in this, and that's what they told me the cross was, and I went, that is not the cross, and that's not what I teach, and that's not what Paul taught. It's not. The fellowship. He did so that Paul would not merely experience the sufferings of Christ, because, okay, look at the change, okay? a messenger of Satan was sent to me of God to buffet me. And so he's going, you know, here's him just experiencing the sufferings. So I was with the Lord because he told me his grace is sufficient and I'm just going to be with the Lord in this. And I don't like it, but, you know, Jesus is my Lord and I'm going to follow him no matter what. And the Lord's going, that is not why I'm allowing this. But here's Paul finding the fellowship of his sufferings. God forbid that I glory but in the afflictions and the suffering, da-da-da-da, because when I am weak, then am I strong. His strength is made perfect in my weakness. He's fellowshipping with the Lord.
Praise God.
He's got it. See, he's trusting death, not just believing in it, not just experiencing it. There has to be, here's what I said. See, one could be a doctrinal point of view. The other one is, I just want to be with Jesus again. It's just another form of being with, I'm fellowshipping in his suffering, so let's just take the his suffering. It's his sufferings, it's not mine. I'm going through this because of his life and nature in me. So it's not even my sufferings, but I'll take it on as mine. Well, those people are, and I've done that before. Those people, this is unfair. You know? It doesn't matter if it's unfair. The cross is always unfair. Do you know that? See, if it's the cross, it's going to be unfair, but we don't want to hear that. No. Well, now, here's what we do. Well, this isn't the cross. This is the devil and his followers, those people that are doing this to me. See, I'm not going to fellowship in these sufferings. I'm not going to fellowship with the devil. You know, I'm not going to do it. No. It is Paul, he's going through it, and he's praying the way we would pray. God, take this away. Take it away. It is the devil. I'm telling you, I know it's the devil. And all he could have got was, I sent him a messenger of Satan to buffet you. Oh. Yes, Lord. Hit me, Satan. You know, some sort of weird, you know, all this stuff. He doesn't do that. He doesn't understand when it starts. A lot of times we don't either. Can I get an amen? We see it just simply as the devil or something else. Sometimes it takes us a while to shake us down and get us where we're in tune, you know. But Paul got it, and he goes, I get this. And now I'm going to not only go through your sufferings, I'm going to fellowship with you in it because I see that the cross is the power of God. I see that this is your way. I see that you're a lamb. I see that if I take this in this spirit, I will glory in this stuff so that your spirit and your nature will rest upon me and the power of that will have an effect. Well, he's not just doing that in himself. I'm a strong Christian. I'm just going to do this with Jesus, and I'm going for the cross. He's fellowshipping with the Lord in it. This is you, and I want this in me. And I want this spirit and this view and everything working in me. And I don't want to always be trying to escape everything.
Amen, Jesus.
Take a breath.